We go on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is our eminent Dr. Jeevan Tithiyal, who heads the RP Center of Ophthalmic Science, a leader amongst leaders in ophthalmology, and he's the best person to tell us on presbyopic phakic IOLs. On to you, Doctor.
Yeah, thank you, Chitra. Indeed, it's my evening, which I've learned so much from all the experts on the phakic IOL. And many discussions we have completed. I think my job is quite simple. I hope I can incite some discussion subsequently on this talk also. We all know we have a large group of patients who are going to be presbyopic. In fact, the future generation will be doing surgery for these patients only. And they all require some sort of a spectacle corrections. And difficult part of us would be those patients who are actually dependent of very, very high power, like high myopia, hypermetropia. Those are a patient who already have some sort of a desire to get corrected. And on that, we have emmetropic people who get presbyopic subsequently. Options, we do have huge number of options, so which may be cornea-based procedures, which we all have talked about in the previous presentations on ARC platform. Now we are looking into lens-based procedure, which we thought about looking for phakic IOLs as an option, or doing some sort of a refractive lens exchange. So I'm going to cover the phakic IOL part today. And we do have two lenses available in a clinical practice. In India, we have IPCL presbyopic from Care Group, which is a hybrid hydrophilic acrylic refractive diffractive design. And we also have Star Evo Viva lens, which is basically aspheric optics, EDOF design, which has the correction up to 2 diopters in the extended depth of focus, may have own advantage of this particular optics. We are awaiting its launch in India so that we can have access to these lenses also. As far as my experience goes, I've used Care Group IPCL presbyopic lenses now almost more than 3 years. And they do give you a large range of dioptric corrections, that is from plus 15 to 30 minus 30 diopters, and cylindrical power up to 10 diopters, which we all discussed, the axis customizable, that is 0 180 degree, and near add ranging from plus 1.5 to 4 diopters. That means it can cover the large range of age group of people who come for this refractive correction phakic IOLs. So sort of the new design is a sort of a trifocal design now, refractive diffractive design. Apart from giving the advantage of a distance near intermediate correction, these lenses do have their own sets of problem also because of a refractive diffractive design. But at this age group with advantage of correction, the other visual phenomena are normally well tolerated by these lenses. Very thin lens in the center, 80 microns, and it also has 380 center flow design, which all discussed may decrease the onset of cataract in these patients. Most importantly, the optic diameter is 6.6 millimeter, which can be customized to a larger diameter, especially the pupil size larger than some of the patients. But what I have seen in the Indian population, the pupil at this age group is not very large. So most patients will fit into these designs as such. And looking into other way of assessment of these patients, we all discussed main important thing will be achieving good vaulting and centration. I think these are two important things for a multifocal design, which you have to use. Centration has to be absolutely perfect, apart from a good counseling for these patients. The surgery is very simple, as we would do for all cases. And as we discussed, people who are well versed with the cataract surgery, they can do this surgery also. This is 2.8 blade, which is being used for these cases. It can go through 2.2 easily also. The lens cartridge is similar to IOL cartridge. There's a little bit of viscoelastic onto the surface. The only problem is that both cartridge and lens is clear. So sometimes it's very difficult to pick up the its orientation. But once you orient correctly, the leaflet which tells you left and right eye, you have to orient differently. The basic advantage of these lenses are they open very slowly, effectively, and it doesn't jerk into the anterior chamber. That is very important. I use 1% sodium hyaluronate in the anterior chamber. Never used hydro implantation, which nowadays people talk about. So it gives a very simple opening. You can see how effectively it goes inside the eye without any, you know, disturbance. You can just wait, see that the openings should be towards the upper area, that the three openings which are there. And once you use Helon, that opening is very slow here. So these openings should be towards the upper area, that is towards the 12 o'clock area. You can see the rings very effectively. The lens positioning is also very easy. It has a 3-point fixation. You can see this is the inferior area, which has been tucked inside. Similarly, both ways, this can be tucked. Viscoelastics should be removed after you orient the lens in a proper axis. Once you remove the viscoelastic, subsequent manipulation should not be done. So I'll orient this lens to axis of desirable area, then remove the viscoelastic effectively in these cases. The advantage we all discussed, the experts have discussed very, very nicely over the refractive lens exchange and over the other ways of correcting. I think it is a reversible procedure and suitable for a larger degree of refractive error, especially larger cylindrical power also. And maybe because of phakic situation, the vitreous changes or vitreous base disturbance will be less in these cases. The chances of for retinal complication will be less. But considering their high myope, they would have their own sets of problems. ACD I normally take more than 3 millimeter considering the older age group of these patients. Pre-op worker, we all discussed. The only thing I add into is the proper iterase examination of all patients, especially looking for aberration profile, internal aberration, and DLI, which is a very important point in these cases. As for corrections concerned, I add 0.5 diopter addition to the reading glasses for these patients for effective correction. This is one patient of mine, 43-year-old male patient with the moderate refractive error, with the good parameters, with the AC depth. I do KCR for all patients to look at angle area also, topographic normal both eyes, and DLI is also normal, very suitable case. DLI is an important part for all examination of phakic IOLFA presbyopia age group. This is another patient. You can see a more internal aberration and DLI is also poor. So this patient may not be a suitable case for phakic IOL. This is one result published, European result on a IPCL with a good outcome. As far as I am concerned, I had a good experience. I had 3 patients with cataract formation within the first 1 year of implantation, despite a good bolt in these cases. One case I had with a methyl cellulose getting stuck between the lens, IPCL surface, and never went off. I had to do cataract surgery with that patient. Pupil size fluctuations there sometimes. This is another patient, 47-year-old, moderate myopia. Good case for a phakic IOL. Entire aberration profile improved subsequent to implantation. Even the MTF improved by these patients. This is one patient. You can see DLI worsen subsequently, though this is a very important indicator in post-op period to assess these patients. Apart from their visual acuity, examination and slit lamp, if you have access to eye trace, that can give you a dysfunctional lens index, and that can be the criteria for assessment of these patients. This is another patient, in fact, improved subsequently after 6 months, MTF and aberration profile. So this is how most patients would do quite okay. In an early post-op, normally I don't dilate these cases because once you dilate, sometimes the ball changes and the near vision can get totally altered if lens doesn't go back to our same position again. So this is a pupillary dilatation and constriction makes almost 150, 200 micron shift in the ball in the IPCL cases. This may be because of a little bit of, because irido IOL or IPCL contact, and especially a patient with a higher degree of refractive error. This is star Evo lens. The one result is there, a 34 eye, 6 months, very good outcome. We are awaiting this lens. Intraop complications similar to all the cases, except for a cataract formation, which may be more in this age group. If this is one of my patients developing cataract subsequent, you can see entire anterior subcapsular cataract is seen from a right from center to periphery. And you can see the vault is only 47. The vault is the major concern for all cases, especially in the presbyopia age group. And surgery, I did cataract surgery for this patient, and subsequently after cataract surgery, implantation of multifocal lens gave a very good results. You can see 6-6 and N6. And these patient assets are very happy with the cataract surgery. As we discussed, their quality of vision is far better than a phakic IOL in these cases. To summarize, presbyopic phakic IOLs is a good option for a suitable patient with a very good pre-op assessment for these patients with a less internal aberration and DLI normal in these cases and better cornea. And whatever results we have seen with the IPCL, they do well. Patients adapt very nicely. And only concern for these patients is we know that presbyopia is a dynamic process. We are not sure what will happen after 5 years of implantation because I'm awaiting that period. Some of my patients are reaching 5 years now. One patient I have to add correction for near, the lens was clear. So that may be situation in these cases, but I'm pretty sure with the reflective refracted Dejan, patient will get adapted to a larger age group range from 5 to 10 years also. Complications are very, very less. I yet to see any patient in glaucoma in this age group. Only cataract is a major problem for these cases. Thank you for your kind listening and happy to answer questions.
Yes, Dr. Tityal, have you ever thought of doing a little residual myopia error in the non-dominant eye? That kind of play have you tried so that to make them even more happy? That's question one. The question two is, you say myopes, you would do that. Since they have also got larger pupil and this is a refractive design, don't you think glare, they would complain about glare. Would that not be an issue?
I'll answer your second question first. Yeah. I've done around 62 bilateral cases now. I do have around 15 to 18% of cases complaining of halos and glare, especially now, night driving. But these patients have got adapted to our situation. So it's not very, very a significant problem for most of these patients, considering the advantage they've get with these lenses. And as far as the cases I have done, most patients are of a higher degree of refractive error. There, I have not tried the type of micro motor vision cases. It may be a good option for those patients who are non-refractive error patient, emmetropic patient getting to presbyopia, or a patient who had a low degree of myopia because they always are very unhappy with whatever we do. Their little micro motor vision might suffice better, but I have no experience in that regard. If Kamal can answer, because he also does these lenses.
Oh, yes, Kamal. Yes, sure.
No. Okay, I think it was beautifully summarized, Dr. Tityal. I couldn't probably add a word to what you said, oodles of information you were giving out there. But yes, I do try to give a slight myopia in these patients by 0.5 in one eye, which is normally, so I'm talking about not giving an higher near add. Let's say if a patient requires, he's around 50 years and he's using plus 1.5. So I would definitely give 2 in one eye, but would I give 2.5 in the other? No, I would just make the other eye a little bit more myopic, which means let's say that the patient is emmetropic and he requires 2, I would give him a plus 0.5 on a spherical level and a near add of 2. So I've done 5 of these cases with one eye slightly bumped off for myopia for distance, not an added enhanced near add. And these patients, nearly 4.5 years, they're doing well. In fact, one of my OT technicians is doing great and he was one of my first few patients. I've also used this lens in a lot of pseudophakic patients as a piggyback. I got a few samples to start with, and even those patients are doing well. I do agree with Dr. Tityal. These patients are more prone to have a little bit of higher incidence of cataract. Doing a Tracy dysfunctional lens mapping DLI index is definitely mandatory for these patients. If I have a DLI index of less than 6 or 6.5, I do not consider these patients. Apart from this, I guess a little bit of glares and halos, yes, higher than my normal multifocal lenses. But overall, I think it's a good level of satisfaction, provided your filtering process is very tight. It needs to be tighter than your normal refractive correction.
I think it's also important to center these lenses like multifocal IOLs on the Purkinje image and all that. No?
Absolutely.
So I'm going
That's
to go
a
on
very
for...
important point.
Do you have any experience of purely correcting the near vision? like patient is emmetrope, they want maybe in one eye if you do this presbyopic correcting lens, yeah, that will also help.
Kamal seems to have an answer. Yes, Kamal?
Yeah, I have three patients like that where the patients were presbyopic, and I was told by the company that, you know, you could just correct one eye and see if it works. And I chose the non-dominant eye. Three of these patients, they 2 years, I think the longest follow-up I have is 2 years. These patients are doing decently well because just correcting one eye and not touch the other, because patients are in the age of 46 months.
How much near eye do you give them?
1.5 approximately. I have a patient who's 47. This lady never wanted to wear glasses. So I just gave a near eye of 1.5 in one eye. And she's doing pretty well and she's very happy. You know, she goes for parties and she can read the menu and, you know, play in a restaurant, play cards. So she's very happy. So she got me two of her friends where I operated. And, you know, but I think doing one eye, the case has to be very, very selected. You need to tell the patient that, you know, the optical quality for near vision is not going to be as good as you expect. It's only one eye working. And if the patient is complying with all your, you know, pre-operative counseling, I think it's a good idea to do one eye in younger patients.
This is more of a clarification. This is more of a clarification with Dr. Tityal. Actually, I have been using these phakic intraocular lenses for a long time. I was wary of doing it for presbyopia. Only after hearing one of your talks sometime back, I ventured into it. And what I find is that, you know, the company, what is available now, IPCL, is from 1.5 to 3.5. But even a plus 3 diopter trifocal lens has only plus 1 diopter for intermediate and plus 2 diopters for near. So the first lens, I was in a 45-year-old. I put a 2.5 diopter and he was not quite happy with the near vision because that was not quite adequate. So though the lenses are available from 1.5 to 3.5, now, whenever I'm using these lenses, even in the younger age group, is only a plus 3 diopter lens. Because that itself gives only plus 2 diopters for near vision and one for intermediate. What is your usual go-to power as far as these lenses are concerned?
You are absolutely correct. I've also gone to the highest power concern for that. In fact, 2.5 to 3 diopter is my choice for all patients. I never go less than 2 because it doesn't give any advantage at all. I've seen my initial cases, one or two patients I implanted, and patients were absolutely unhappy because their near vision was as good as nothing begin with. Then I said, I'll go for a full correction.
The patient is wearing 1.5 add. So you think, okay, you'll give him plus 2 add. It doesn't work. You have to give them
doesn't a work
plus
at all. Yeah.
I'm going to go on to the next speaker.
Yeah, just one question, just for my clarification. When you do this in one eye, do you give a monovision contact lens trial before you embark on surgery for these patients, or you straight away go ahead and do the surgery?
I think Kamal can answer. I have not done
this. So what we do is, first of all, we find the dominant eye, and then we find what is the lowest refractive error for near eye, which this patient is okay with at an intermediate. And based on that, I have done 0.5 overcorrection. And these patients are good to go. You know, what they're mostly looking at is not a very good near vision. They've had a good counseling time. So what we give them is a decent intermediate vision. And in a decent mesopic condition, these three ladies I'm talking about, I've done one eye each, they're doing great. They're very happy. It's been two years plus and they're doing very well.
Yes, Sri Ganesh.
Yeah. I want to talk about my experience. I've not used presbyopic phakic IOLs, but in older patients over 40, what I do is I plan for a monovision of about 1.75 diopters. And most of these patients wearing contact lenses already are wearing monovision contact lenses. The high myopes wearing monovision contact lenses, they're already neuro-adapted, used to it. So all you have to do is do a monovision with a phakic IOL. And with a phakic IOL, they actually get improvement in best corrected vision. So they are extremely happy. And they don't have night vision problems. If you put a presbyopic phakic IOL, they have night vision issues. If you undercorrect them in one eye, if you have a defocus with a diffractive optic, then the glare and halos are much more. So I would not suggest undercorrecting them in one eye with presbyopic diffractive phakic IOL because it's going to worsen their night vision and dysphotopsia. So I prefer to do a monovision with ICLs, and these patients are extremely happy.
After a good variety of options which have come to us for the presbyopia,